trying to connect.
Can you listen? Okay. Thanks for surviving to the last talk today. I'm going to talk about colors in graffiti. And graffiti is a very general term that can be applied for inscriptions back to the Roman empires or empire or even before, all the way to nowadays, many different types of interventions in public walls. For example, this one. I don't know if you noticed on your way coming here to the conference, you could see this one and this one. But our study is not about this kind of graffiti, and it's about this kind, which is also in Riga. It's considered the largest Latvian graffiti, 30 minutes walking from here. So that's, it's also known by street art, and that's what I'm going to present today. Here is another example from the famous Brazilian brothers and twins. And here, probably everybody knows Banksy, which was sold for more than 1 million, and it's the most famous graffiti in the world, and the one that is the most expensive one, that was almost 2 million. I don't know if you were aware of Banksy, but for those who are not aware, we don't know if we are talking about a woman or a man, because we don't know his or her identity. And back to 2016, Sergio's group was studying the statistics of colors, comparing paintings and natural scenes, and then we decided to do the same for the graffiti. As you were watching today, attending the presentation of Sho, he was doing the same thing with Japanese paintings, and you can visit Katarina's poster, which is about children's paintings. So we decided to do the same thing for the graffiti, and the goals of our study were to study the chromatic structure of graffiti and to compare this statistic of colors of graffiti with those of more traditional paintings. So for the method, we decided to take graffiti photos in São Paulo, which is very well known for the graffiti production. And it's a big city. We have a population that is more than 10 times the Latvian population, more than 20 million. We took 245 photos, and 17 were excluded for non-uniform illumination. And then we were divided in 5 zones, and in total we had 228 photos. So we had 55 in the center, 26 in the north, 59 in the south zone, that took me almost 3 hours to get there driving, 44 in the east, almost 2 hours to go and then more 2 hours to come back, and then 44 in the west zone. So what was the methodology to take these photos? We were arriving in the place with the graffitis, which was usually an alley or an avenue, and we were taking pictures from the right side, from the beginning all the way to the end, and then coming back and take pictures from the left side. We were not taking pictures of those ones with a lot of like lights and shades. So, and also the ones that were exclusively in black and white. Other than that, we were taking all the other pictures, whether we like it or not. So just for you to have a feeling, I have here a few examples. We were using this Nikon camera with a very high resolution. We were including in the field of view of the photo, the color chart, for calibration purposes. So every single photo we had the color chart, as you can see here. And right before taking the picture with the color chart, we were measuring the spectrum of the illumination for every single picture, the moment right before taking the photo with the color chart. Here was just 1 second after using the equipment. So then we had, for every single graffiti photo, we were having to do the standard corrections for the color signals. And then after that, transforming the color signals to the lab space. So just a reminder, in the lab space, we were concentrating our data in the horizontal axis, and all the graphs that I'm going to show are with the A axis coming from the red A positive to the green negative, and in the B axis from the positive yellow to the negative blue. So here is just an example of the effect of the correction in the lab space. As you can see, the black cross are the corrected points. They are much closer to the blue dots that are the real than to the red dots that were the uncorrected ones. So for example, just for you to have an idea, we were having the color gamut of this graffiti, for example, which is by coincidence, one of my favorites. His name is Mowgli. And here we have the color gamut. And as you can see, the color gamut is concentrated in the second quadrant because it has lots of greens and yellows. Here, another example and a very different color gamut because it's concentrated in the first quadrant with lots of reds and yellows. So to characterize the color gamut, we computed the ellipses that were such that the major axis and the minor axis were aligned with the people, with the principal directions. And the size of the axis were 2 times the standard deviation. So then we could have the 3 necessary parameters, the axis ratio, that was the minor axis divided by the major, the angle that was between the major axis and the positive A axis, and the area that was usually concentrating for the graffiti 80% of the points inside the ellipsis area. So here, again, the Mowgli. As you can see, the angle was a very high with 146 degrees, and the other one was a very different angle, just 10 degrees. But their axis ratio were very similar, and also the area, more than 2,000 units. If we take in consideration all these 228 photos of the graffiti, as the color gamut, we had this result. And comparing to the natural scenes, they were very much similar. And when we compared it with the paintings, the paintings were much smaller. So for the axis ratio here in the dashed lines, we can see if the distribution, if the colors were chosen in a random way, but they were not, so the circles are the point of the data, fitted in the Gaussian. And as an example, a very small X ratio, an example of the most frequent X ratio, and a very high one, 0.99. If we compare the axis ratio with the natural scenes and the paintings, we can see that they are very similar, and there were no difference among them. For the angle, here again the dashed line, if the colors were chosen in a random way, and here is the distribution of the angle for the graffiti, an example of the 10 degree, an example from the 90 degrees, and an example for a very high angle. Comparing with the natural scenes and paintings, we can see that they differ among each other, although there is a tendency of the graffiti and paintings to be more similar, with the maximum very similar, but the angle for the paintings are much narrow in distribution compared to the graffitis that are spread out. And for the area, here we have the distribution of the area for the graffiti with an example of the most frequent, which is like a little bit more than 1,000 units in the lab space. This a very high one with more than 6,000 units, and comparing to the natural scenes and to paintings, they are very similar, although there's a tendency for the graffiti to be larger in areas. So for the conclusion, just a parenthesis before I give you the conclusion, here are the pictures of me and my co-author, the photographer, and with the two guys from the two zones that we were taking pictures inside the favela. And to go to the favela, we not only need permission, but we need a guide. And this was the two guys from the north, from the east zone, and from the south zone, the farthest ones. So, graffiti have chromatic structures very similar to those of more traditional paintings. However, the distribution of the gamut orientation are much broader than for the those of the traditional paintings, suggesting that the graffiti artists have more freedom in the use of color. Thanks.
Thank you. We have time for questions. Behind you.
It's a fascinating presentation. Brazil may be blessed with more artistic graffiti than, sadly, in the UK. Do you think there, I'm sure there are awful differences between countries. The exposure in Manchester is largely monochrome with lots of silver and black, mainly black. Do you not find this also in Brazil, or are they always as colorful as you've shown?
We did a lot of measurements considering the internet database. So I did a rank of the most famous cities for graffiti, and there were six, if I'm not wrong. And one of them is London. Brighton comes, I think, right after. Melbourne and all the cities. They have much more similarities because they're all very, very colorful. Either if you are in a hot country like Brazil, we are colorful. But if you live like in London or Chicago, for example, you are desperate for color too. so it's much more like similar. But in the beginning, like Banksy, it's a very good example. It was completely forbidden. So they were just going for two or three colors. Because they sometimes would have just a few seconds for doing the graffiti. And I think that's why probably Banksy started with the stencil. And he would just have to count seconds. But now, for example, the ones that I was taking pictures, they are alleys that it's paid by the government, including. So you have the permission, so they have much more time to elaborate and to paint.
Okay, thank you. More questions?
So graffiti artists, they seem to have more freedom of colors. So they can use even more saturated colors. Could it be because it's at least these graffiti, they are a modern art form, they have access to more recent pigments and more saturated pigments in comparison to the painting?
We were checking for the pigments, and it seems that for the oil painting, like in the European paintings, we have a lot of availability of pigments in the second and the third quadrant. Not so much for, no, the first and the third, not so much for the second and the fourth. But I cannot tell you for sure that the graffiti artists, they have access to pigments that are uniform in all the color space, let's say, because we are still collecting the data, but it seems that maybe that's the reason.
Okay, thank you.